Sarah and Ginger were talking to us about reporting. They're both long-form narrative investigators and narrative writers. But we also need to talk about pictures. And that's what we're going to do for the next little while. Particularly on no issue more than on the issue of migrants and refugees and children, photographs and visual storytelling, of course, have a unique power to inform and to motivate, and also a unique power to mislead. Visual journalism has a unique capacity to dignify deeply traumatized survivors of challenging experience, and also an exceptional power to degrade and stigmatize. To engage with all of the deep questions of effective and ethical and powerfully motivating journalism with images and pictures and video, we're really lucky to have three colleagues here who are just the best. All three, by coincidence, are also Dart Center Uckberg Fellows, spanning the entire history of the Dart Center, really. In Donna's case, Donna was a Dart Center Uckberg Fellow, I think, in the second year we had the program, which is now a frighteningly long time ago for some of us. We're here with Donna De Cesare, Laila, Al-Arian, and Almudena Toral. Donna, the way we're going to work this is that Donna, who is a veteran photographer and a professor of photojournalism at the University of Texas, is going to lead us through a kind of substantial presentation and discussion on visual depiction of refugees. It's going to lay out some themes and some language. Then Laila is going to talk about, I think, a project that she did called The Ban, and show some excerpts from that. Laila is now the executive producer, is that the correct title, of Fault Lines at Al Jazeera English, a great investigative program. And then Almudena Toral from Univision is going to show and talk about a remarkably insightful piece of television she did last year about the return of a young child, of a separated young child, to her village in Guatemala, which to my mind shows, I've already held up on a number of occasions over the course of the last few months, as an example of how, no, it really is possible to report and depict the lives of very young children with insight and clarity and dignity. So each of them will present in sequence. Again, as we did with a big panel earlier, I'd ask you to kind of jot down your questions, hold them. So we'll do the three presentations in sequence, and then we'll have a conversation. And we're running a little late. We're going to go for the full time. We won't shortchange anything about the day. Donna, take us where we need to go.
Thank you. And thank all of you for being here and being so interested in this subject. Over the last several days, we've learned about the ways that uprooting caused by war, poverty, and climate change impacts the development of children. I want to begin by referencing the remarks of Masha Gessen, who writes for The New Yorker and is one of the most thoughtful and clear-sighted contemporary journalists writing about refugees and immigrants. In her acceptance speech for the 2016 Hitchens Prize, Gessen made clear her view that reporting on displacement and uprooting is a moral imperative. She begins, "More than half a century ago, Hannah Arendt described the state of being a refugee, both as an experience and as a political predicament. In her essay, We Refugees, she wrote, We lost our home, which means the familiarity of daily life. We lost our occupation, which means the confidence that we are of some use in the world. We lost our language, which means the naturalness of reactions, the simplicity of gestures, the unaffected expression of feelings. Gessen then turns to Arendt's signature work, The Origins of Totalitarianism, to describe the way the right to have rights is also a problem for us today. This problem of humanizing and dehumanizing is one we all participate in. We drift into adopting categories and language of the state so easily, migrants, caravans, aliens, illegals. As Gessen points out, such language is not merely descriptive. It narrows the space of disagreement with policies fueled by hatred and aggression. It also creates a hierarchy of stories for writers and image makers and their readers. Dramatic, wrenching stories of crisis overshadow stories that are quieter, diverse, complex, and equally important. The job of holding power to account goes beyond calculations about the number of eyeballs an article or an image may draw, as important as viral reach might be. We know from visual research that the personal story is more memorable. It offers the viewer more entry points of connection to an experience that may be unfamiliar or deeply disturbing. Images impact our emotions, and when we connect through them, we feel empathy. Journalists sometimes make images of truths their audience would prefer not to see. Editors and publishers struggle over how to show harrowing images that are newsworthy and in the public interest without being gratuitous or repelling audiences. I'd like us to reflect on the publication, impact, and afterlives of four such photographs published over the last 5 years. You probably recognize them all. All were widely published and had extended lives on social media as they were shared, became memes, or inspired imitation by artists. All depict young children, two to break strong ethical taboos on showing lifeless children, to reveal in a child's expression emotional shock or painful turmoil. In the case of the Syrian child, Alan Kurdi, photographer Niloufer Demir made several different framings, most of them showing the Turkish policeman who found Kurdi's body. In the UK, most news editors opted for the image of the police officer holding the child, and studies show that this choice was consistent with picture editors in the US. By contrast, a study of social media sharing found that it was the image of the child alone on the beach that was shared more frequently. What is undeniable, according to academics and NGOs, is that the viral image of Alan Kurdi bolstered interest in the fate of refugees and in volunteering, campaigning, and donations to groups working on the issue. Alan Kurdi's image provided an identified individual victim who became emblematic, standing in for the refugees seeking safety in Europe. A study from the University of Sheffield Social Media Lab noted a lasting shift in language describing Syrians entering Europe. After the public saw Alan Kurdi's photograph, the word refugee began replacing the word migrant in media stories and public discussions of Syrians in Europe. On the other hand, the initial easing of restrictions on Syrians entering Europe was short-lived. The Sheffield team also noted on their copyright page that they had kept the misspelling of Kurdi's first name, saying that Aylan was the name associated with the initial viral reach of the photograph. We only learned that he was called Alan when his surviving family asked the media to correct his name and publish family photographs of Alan taken before his death. I want to turn now to the image of another Syrian child. Coming a year after the image of Alan Kurdi and after many news reports, including videotaped pleas for help from children in Syrian cities under siege. This image of Amran Dakhnish spread quickly on social media and caught the attention of many news editors. Speaking to NPR, Marianne Golan, director of photography for The Washington Post, observed, It's heartbreaking, compelling, beautifully composed, scary. Any mother in the world would want to scoop him up and take care of him. The New York Times ran the photograph on the front page, as did many other international news outlets. Commentators speculated that Omran's image could change the course of the Syrian conflict. NPR asked, is this the picture that will end the Syrian war? John Hillary, the executive director of War on Want, a global justice organization, was skeptical. Images on their own can provoke feelings and awareness, but they can't give you the sort of political understanding and analysis that you need to respond properly. That's the most profound difficulty of this image. There isn't an obvious mechanism through which we can turn our anger or compassion into change. Our decontextualized understanding of Omran's situation and his family's plight was complicated a year later when the Syrian state media published interviews in which Omran's father, Mohammed Dagnish, complained that rebel groups and Western media had used images of his son as propaganda tools. According to Omran's father, the White Helmets emergency responders arrived shortly after their home was hit and helped to evacuate the family. They took Omran, got him to the ambulance, where they filmed him, Mr. Dagnish said. It was against my will. I was still upstairs in the house. If Omran was 4 years old in 2017, as stated by the reporters on Syrian state television, he would have been 3 years old, not 5 years old, when the original image appeared. The New York Times, in their follow-up reporting, noted the verification challenges that news organizations face when images go viral so quickly. They also noted that Syrians appearing on state television or on channels associated with the Assad government are seldom able to speak freely. Supporters of the Assad government and rebel opposition activists have been quick to accuse each other of using Omran to further their own agenda. How Omran's photograph impacted his family's safety and whether they were pressured to speak when and where they finally did are unknown. When photographer John Moore was interviewed about the image he made of Yanela Sanchez and as her mother was being searched by the Border Patrol, he told The Atlantic, as a father, it was very emotional for me just to hear those cries. When I saw this little girl break down in tears, I wanted to comfort this child. But as a photojournalist, we sometimes have to keep photographing when things are hard and tell the story that people would not see otherwise. Although the photo caption did not suggest that it was known that the child and mother would be separated, the image went viral in a period when the controversy over the zero-tolerance immigration policy had put more than 2,000 children in legal limbo and was read immediately as an indictment. The New York Daily News cropped the context from Moore's image, connecting the child's pain with policy. Time magazine created a photo illustration, which they defended, arguing our cover and reporting capture the stakes of this moment. When the decontextualized, captionless image went viral, a California couple used it in a fundraising effort to assist the nonprofit group Raices with efforts to secure legal assistance to reunite children with their families. But a war of memes ensued. It was another wider frame with more context that won the Picture of a Year award from World Press. Here we see that a Border Patrol agent is removing the mother's belt as part of preparation for detention. That's the intake procedure all asylum seekers go through. Both mother and child have already had their shoelaces removed in their first encounter with the country where they hope to be granted safety. One of the things that happened when the Associated Press published this haunting photograph of Oscar and Valeria Martinez was that commentators made immediate comparison to the image of Alan Kurdi, speculating about the power of the image to counteract the recently enacted Remain in Mexico protocol for asylum seekers. The National Association of Hispanic Journalists issued a critical press release describing the photograph as exploitative and dehumanizing. The NAHH president, Hugo Balta, told the Poynter Institute that not a lot of thought was given to the impact that image would have with the community and the audience. The Latino community is made to feel like it's being taken advantage of. The New York Times often engages in an explanation of their editorial decision-making when publishing difficult front-page images. They offered such a response to explain their editorial process when a reader wrote, "I understand that the photograph that you have with your story is meant to somehow transmit a message, perhaps convey pain and trauma, make us feel shame and sadness, and thereby ignite change. But somehow I also find it thoroughly humiliating, disrespectful as well." The view from El Salvador is instructive. El Faro's public editor explained that the shock people were expressing there relates to the invisibility or stigma. For the 1.4 million Salvadorans who have managed to overcome the most incredible obstacles and dangers to land in the United States, there's finally a recognition of the others, the thousands who have fallen on that deadly route, victims to smugglers and organized crime. And so we journalists go forward with the image of Oscar Martinez hugging Valeria embedded in our soul, the editor at El Faro wrote. Trying to do what good journalism does, we refuse to allow massacres, abuses, murders, and the misery that kills to continue. For if such stories leave us indifferent, this impunity will remain. Those words of my Salvadoran colleagues give me hope. I have long been committed to telling stories of social injustice in El Salvador and other parts of Latin America, especially stories concerning children. Almost 20 years ago, I began a project picturing abused children for UNICEF. At that time, there was a growing awareness about the need to protect the visual identities of children in cases where the visual depiction stigmatizes or is in itself an aspect of the abuse. The time I spent with a group of psychologists in Bogota helped me to think about the ways to picture children who needed such protection. I found I could make better portrait images by developing a relationship and interviewing people first, and then working to make the picture-making process more collaborative, giving the children agency in the process. 15-year-old Mizrael asked me to make his portrait behind the curtain after we spoke about his struggle with HIV-related illness. "When you take the photograph, can I keep my clothes on?" Monica asked me. I was taken aback. I had explained that I was photographing for UNICEF. It was a poignant reminder to me of the power we wield when we hold cameras, and of the fact that being photographed may bring up painful or coercive associations related to abuse, even when you think that you've made who you are and what you want to do, telling the story, clear. I talked to Rosario on a number of occasions before she told me about the abuse she'd suffered at the hands of Guatemalan police and about the organization that was helping to protect her during her efforts to seek justice. Later, when I asked how she wanted to be photographed, she took me to the abandoned streets where she had once lived and hid her face as she held on to an electrical post. At a retreat for child survivors of landmine explosions, Carolina was self-conscious about being photographed. She asked me to wait for a moment when she wasn't expecting me to photograph her. When she began fixing her hair, I saw a way to capture a candid moment and protect the identity of a 16-year-old former child soldier who longed for a normal teenage life. This family of orphaned siblings are survivors of one of Colombia's worst massacres. As we all began to climb a hill to see the massacre site, Nancy noticed their shadows. She told the others, "Let's hold hands to show we are united." Myra Hernandez, age 8, survived a bombing attack in a Colombian conflict zone that killed her father and grandparents. Myra told me, "I didn't think anything at first. I didn't know my father was dead. I didn't know my leg was mush. When they brought me to Bogota, the doctors here told me that my leg was infected and it would kill me if they didn't amputate." I told him, let me die. But the surgeon who operated on me saved my life. The psychologist told me I could learn to walk again. I didn't believe her, but she was right. Little by little, you learn to do things again, new things. This weekend was the first time I was in a pool. I got in and I learned to swim. I followed the story of Myra's recovery process. It's clear also that we need narratives that demonstrate dreams and struggles to overcome the impact of violence and displacement, that show that our story's subjects are protagonists in their own recovery process. Stories and images that celebrate successes and honor the critical role that solidarity from family and community plays in supporting children's resistance and recovery. A few brief tips may be helpful. We talked about some of these things before, and as Catherine mentioned earlier today, in addition to getting informed consent from a parent or guardian, it's also important to frame the encounter. In fast-moving, unfolding situations or crises that occur in public space, parental consent may not be possible. But we should always try to get contact information so that we can do follow-up reporting. We should adopt a collaborative process, a plan ahead of time when we are thinking about making a portrait. You know, we all go in with our own ideas, but listening to what people are telling us may give us better ideas and also give them agency in the process of working together. I like to involve children in the image making process as much as possible, and I usually bring an extra camera along with me, a point and shoot camera that I can give to them and let them play with. This helps, you know, it sort of enables them to feel agency and a sense of playfulness and exploration, but it also helps in that process that we were talking about earlier about restoring composure and grounding. The camera itself can be then part of that process for the child. It also is effective when you want to distract a child from listening in to non-age appropriate conversations with adults who maybe you need to talk to. Sometimes when a child or adolescent speaks the language of the reporter, it can be tempting for both the parent and the reporter to ask the young person to translate. This may not be ideal. Why not? Anyone have some ideas about that? Why might that not be helpful? What? Yes. Yeah. So the child might feel they're being used. The child also may be, you know, the parent is connecting to you and sometimes may forget it's their child, and they may not have spoken to their child about the things they're about to reveal to you. This is not the way that children should learn about what their parents are feeling and going through. So it's a very disempowering situation for everyone. So it's really, you know, if it's just straight information that's not sensitive, maybe it's okay. But really, you should be prepared to have translation help if you're going to need it. Make sure that people understand your role and that the conversation about how the images are going to be published, right? And so I always say, you know, now that we live in this digital age, it doesn't matter where you are. The images are going to be public. So when I tell people, yes, I'm publishing this for UNICEF, but UNICEF will put this online and your neighbors will be able to see it. So at least they know that people in their community are going to be, you know, have the capacity to see the story as well. And this then enables you to get into that conversation that you need to have about any needs to protect identity or sensitive subject matter that you can't touch upon. You have to have ground rules when you're working with children. And attentive, compassionate listening. I mean, we can't stress that enough. Catherine's tips for interviewing apply to our conversation. We have to be attentive and compassionate listeners, and without becoming confused about our role, because that can cause unintended harm. And the point that she made about the difficulty about how much of your own point, if you have a point of connection that you want to say to a young person, you know, I've been through something similar myself, you know, don't go too far, because obviously the focus is on their experience, not on you. We do sometimes need images of extreme situations to shock us awake, but the truth is that we ask too much of viral images. To scale this challenge of reporting on refugees, a different mindset about imagery is needed. We must remember Hannah Arendt's words about what refugees lose and focus on diverse stories that expand compassion, but also understanding of people's agency and creativity as they rebuild, repair, integrate, or recreate a sense of home. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much to the Dart Center for inviting me. Actually, this project that I'm about to share with you and talk to you about is part of the reason I came to the Dart Center for the Ockberg Fellowship. It was 2017. It was a year that I did two short documentaries focused on children, and I didn't anticipate how that would impact me because both of those were related to children and trauma or children and families going through traumatic experiences. So this project, the ban, is about the travel ban, also known as the Muslim ban, one of the first decisions that Donald Trump made as president. And shortly after the ban went into effect, we got on a plane. Well, first we looked and we tried to find people who were directly impacted by the policy. Obviously, we're talking about seven Muslim-majority countries. So there were, you know, hundreds of thousands of people all over the world, millions of people, impacted by this policy, and we wanted to find the most vulnerable. So there was a decision made kind of early on. I think part of what you were talking about, that fatigue, that feeling of, okay, this story has been told before, or how do you make people pay attention? How do you make them care? So we kind of made an editorial storytelling decision to focus on the most vulnerable people impacted by this policy, children and refugees. And this is the story. What I'll share is a few clips. It's a 25-minute documentary. I'll share about 5 to 6 minutes of it, just to give you a sense of the story, some of the decisions we made, and then I'll talk for a few minutes about sort of lessons learned and kind of things that happened during this project. But yeah, this is the ban. I'll start it from here.
أنا سوري، أنا عندي أطفال مريضين اثنين، من سوريا أنا، صار لي 6 سنين هون، بعاني من مشفى لمشفى.
We received this video not long after Donald Trump issued a temporary travel ban against citizens of seven Muslim-majority countries. Syrian refugees were also banned indefinitely. It's a plea from a Syrian father in Turkey, desperate to bring his family to America. At a time the government decided it didn't want them.
وهي وضع أولادي هاي ابني المريض اللي عمره 2 تقولوا عمره 6 شهور ما له علاجه هاي مرضه وهي السيرونات وهلا أنا في المستشفى هاي مستشفى وهي أجهزة وهي ابني الثاني عمره 7 سنين
This is a story about a race against time and the consequences of a blanket policy that closes America's doors to those with the most to lose. The Syrian man, Abdul Ghani, said he'd been cleared to come to the US with his family on February 1st. But they're now unable to.
أهلا وسهلا أستاذ شو.
he met us outside of a hospital where his two sons were being treated for a rare genetic disorder.
What does he have on his skin? ممكن تورينا؟
تمام.
And is it getting worse?
إيه كتير.
So he didn't look like this when he was born. It's getting worse.
نعم شوي شوي صار.
Is there pain?
يحس فيه.
And your older son, where is he?
ابني بالعناية مشددة هلا.
How long has he been in intensive care?
صار له نهارين.
We tried to see Yahya in the ICU, but the hospital staff wouldn't let us. This is the video that his father took for us as his son was struggling to breathe.
عدم طالع الاكسجين 84 ومحطوط.
How do you feel when you see him like that?
ضايع. يعني عم بقدر شاد ما عم بقدر بسعى فيه ما عم بقدر ما عم بطلع شيء بايدي.
On the last day we were in Istanbul, we got a message from Abdul Ghani. He told us that after 5 days in the ICU, Yahya died. He was 6 years old. These are the last pictures of him alive. Yahya was never moved from the hospital.
أنا أكثر من شهرين صار لي هوني شهرين ونص كل ما بقول عندهم من أول ما جيت بيقولوا لي اللي تمام أنت بدك تروح على أمريكا.
Did they say how he died?
من قتل من السبب ومن قتل السرطانية اللي في الرئة وفي القناة الصفراوية.
Through multiple sources, we learned that the family's security clearance to the US may have lapsed. UNHCR has told them they're now trying to move them to Germany. But as they wait for that day, Abdul Ghani and his wife are growing more desperate to get treatment for their two-year-old, who's gotten worse since his brother died. Wherever they end up, they say Yahya's death has left a hole in their lives that can never be filled.
When's the last time you spoke to him?
الساعه 12 امبارح. بس اخر كلمه حكاها معي من 5 ايام. الله يرحمه.
قال لك ايه؟
قبل لي هيك باي.
That was the hardest thing I'd ever had to do as a journalist, which is ask a grieving father if you do an interview with us after shortly after his son had died. And it's a decision he had to think about, and it's a decision on my part that I still think about to this day, whether it was right of me to even ask him to do the interview. It was our last day in Istanbul. He texted me around 5 a.m. and told me what happened, that his son had passed away. So I knew that he wanted me to know. I called him when I woke up, and I asked him if we could come to the hospital. He said yes. And when we got there, I asked him if he would talk to us, and he had to think about it, but he said yes. He wanted the world to know his story, his family's story, and his son's story. But I think what covering this family's you know, traumatic moment. What it showed me was the challenge of covering a family story in the midst of a crisis. I think we talked a lot today about the challenges of getting people to talk about past trauma, not re-traumatizing them. But I think for me, it was navigating a lot of different difficult questions of covering a family story as it was happening. And one of the things I had to constantly think about is the power dynamics between us as a Western, based group of journalists, who come from relative privilege, to refugees who, are living in difficult circumstances and who truly believe that we are there to get them out of their situation. So it was constantly managing expectations and reminding them what our role is, which is to inform, hopefully to move as well, but first and foremost to inform the public about the real life consequences of these policies. So I think it was constantly just being aware of these power dynamics, managing expectations, and being really transparent about who we were and what we were doing, which is something that I think is easier when you have a big camera. So I think like there's a little bit less ambiguity about whether you're gonna use the interview. It's there. We also always ask our the people who appear in our documentaries to sign release forms. In cases where they don't read or write, we explain what's in the release form. But that also, I think, early on establishes, yes, like we're journalists, we're here to cover your story. I think one of the sort of kind of difficult things to navigate or potential contradictions is the fact that we were there the whole time, you know, kind of trying to manage his expectations, you know, telling him, yes, we're asking the UN about your case, but we can't, you know, force them to do anything about your case. We're journalists, we're not, we don't work for the UN, we're not advocates. But then after our story came out, luckily for the family, it actually did have some impact. We learned that the Turkish president actually moved the younger son to a much better hospital. Some viewers raised money for the family online. UNHCR actually expedited their case and resettled them to Germany. So it's kind of, in a way, it's just like, again, making clear with the families we talk to that this is just, you know, it happens to be a result of the work, but it's not something we did preemptively. I think as we talked a lot about just the importance of consent, this story wasn't, we didn't interview any of the children. They were, obviously Yahya was in the ICU, his younger brother was only two, the sister that you see was 4 years old, so, and there wasn't really an editorial reason to interview them, but it was just, again, constantly making sure that the parents were aware of everything we were using, the fact that we were filming their children. I was in constant touch in the edit process with the father to make sure he knew we would use the photos, the videos that he sent us, as well as kind of the personal home videos. So it's just like, I think it's a way of empowering the subject or the people who tell us their stories by just remaining in touch throughout even the sort of publishing process, not so much telling them like, this is everything that's coming out, but especially when it comes to their own photos and videos to make sure they're aware that we would use them. Making sure children are interviewed in the presence of an adult, something we talked about, stopping the interview if kids feel like they're distressed. I think I mentioned release forms. We also make sure that they're translated in languages, so whether it's Spanish or Arabic or whatever it is. I think in this situation, it was really important that the team, myself and Sharif, the correspondent, both speak Arabic. And I think, I can't speak enough about the importance of having some, at least one member of the team kind of connected to the culture that you're covering. So I think it really informed our journalism that we could communicate with the father directly, that we understood some of the cultural nuances. For example, the mom didn't want her to appear on camera, and kind of respecting that and not pressuring her. So it's, I will just make a call for newsrooms to be more diverse because I think it really helps inform the reporting and makes the process more sensitive. The other thing to keep in mind with reporting on refugees is just the countries that are in the cultural context of where you're reporting. So in our case, it was Turkey. Turkey was the country that absorbed the largest number of Syrian refugees. but it was also a place where it could be a bit tricky as press to operate. So when we were filming on the streets, we were constantly stopped and told not to film. Filming in the hospital, we basically had to smuggle the camera in my big purse. You know, if you're a woman with on a shoot, take a big purse to smuggle cameras. That's one piece of advice I would have. I constantly had to think about the balance between telling the story, but also not putting the family we were following at risk, making sure that they weren't being followed, that there weren't going to be any repercussions to following him around basically with a camera. And then another sort of challenge that I had was, in this specific case, verifying every aspect of their story. So neither the UN or the State Department wanted to talk about a specific case. So I had to just be very persistent, keep digging, and really find creative ways to verify aspects of their story and details of their case. We had to translate the younger brother's medical documents from Turkish to English, speak to medical experts on the genetic disorder that both brothers had. And because immigration and the travel ban, whether we're talking about family separation or the travel ban, it's such a loaded topic that people will seize on any little mistake to discredit your entire piece. So I felt like it was my responsibility, not just as a journalist to get everything accurate, but to this family to make sure that we didn't get anything wrong. I wanted to sort of end on two points because I think I'm running out of time. One is that just the power of storytelling. I think it was one of the reasons this piece resonated with people is because we did focus on two families and two cases. I wasn't able to share the other one, but it's of a toddler named Dilbarin, who is Iraqi Yazidi, who'd been burned in a fire in a refugee camp. He came to the U.S. for medical treatment, but became separated from his parents when it was time for him to have surgery. But I just think there's something about sometimes when a policy is so huge and it can feel tough to digest, there's a power to kind of focusing on the micro, like focusing on just a couple of really human stories and unpacking the devastating consequences of that policy through this very narrow lens, because I think people can really connect with it that way. And it's also the power of following a story as it's unfolding. I think there's a certain urgency to it. It does, some tricky ethical questions come up for sure that I think can be tough to navigate, but I think as far as storytelling, it can really grab a viewer's and engage a viewer, as we're here to talk about. One interesting part of this reporting process was a conversation internally that we had about whether, you know, sort of highlighting the plight of children who are so vulnerable would actually reach the other side, or, you know, people who may support these policies. So I actually, one part of the documentaries, we talked to a Republican Congress member who defended the travel ban and said, you know, he sort of like deflected, and when we would ask him specifically about this case, he said, "I sympathize with American victims. We can't just give examples on one side, but be ignorant of the innocent Americans who expect their government to protect them first." We weren't sure what that had to do with Yahya, but and then I also sent this to a Trump supporter that I had interviewed for a previous documentary, and she wrote back and said that she agreed with the congressman. So it was just interesting to kind of use that as a very limited social experiment of whether a story like this could change minds of people who've already had their mind made up. I think I only have one more minute left, so just two last points. One is just the importance of accountability for this family that opened up so much to us. So we did go to the White House to try to ask President Trump about this policy directly. We did also ask Paul Ryan why he flip-flopped. So we just felt like a really integral part of this reporting process was to not just focus on their plight, but also to take it all the way to the decision makers and try to ask those tough questions using this case, basically putting it in front of them. And finally, I just wanted to end on the note of how important it is. I know as journalists, it can be really overwhelming to keep in touch with everybody we interview, especially if you do this day in and day out and you meet a lot of people. But I think when you cover such a traumatic story in the way we did, I felt an obligation to keep in touch with the family. and just check up on them as much as possible. And I remain in touch with them to this day, maybe not as regularly as I'd like, but I just felt like you don't want to feel like you're popping into someone's life when they're in their worst moment and then you just kind of disappear. I think it can feel really exploitative. So just kind of, you know, making sure you're giving them that dignity of keeping in touch with them on a very human basis. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. So a lot of you know me already, but I wanted to talk about one specific project that I did last year. But first, for those of you who are not from the US, and there's a lot of people who are international in this room, I wanted to give a bit of context of Univision, the TV channel where I work for. It's a Hispanic TV channel, so we serve the Latino and Hispanic community in the US. It's a really huge community. We serve first and second generation immigrants in Spanish. But something really changed in our coverage, at least on the digital side where I work, back in 2016 when Trump got elected, because we felt like we have all this knowledge and all these reporters who have been covering immigration for many, many years and give voice to this community and do public service journalism with this community. But we also felt, well, here we have a president that directly attacks the community we cover, and we felt some sort of responsibility to not only give voice to the community, but make sure that that voice was heard outside of the community. So we started translating a lot more of our work in English. And the piece I'm gonna show, it's one of the ones that we thought this is a voice that should be heard not only for the Hispanic community, but in a wider context. And I also wanted to emphasize, as a visual person and a visual team, the power of images as a universal language and the huge power that they have to convey emotion. So the project that I was gonna talk about is a short documentary. It's 9 minutes long that we did last year on a 6-year-old girl from Guatemala. Her name is Arayansi, and she was one of the thousands of kids that were separated by the zero tolerance policy at the border. Ginger talked a lot about this earlier. And so she was, traveling with her dad. She got separated at the border, and she was separated for 3.5 months and then deported back to Guatemala. I'm gonna show two clips from the short film and then talk a little bit more about the behind the scenes.
La niña tiene que pagar la condena de su papá. Ella viene una niña muy diferente.
Cuando uno produce este tipo de miedo en un niño, está produciendo un daño irreparable.
Y mi mamá se llama Lucero Lucerito y mi hermanito. Peleamos mucho.
Cuando nació mi hija me sentí el hombre más feliz en esta vida. Y de ahí se me vino esa idea de irme a Estados Unidos con ella para darle estudio. Yo crucé como el 12 de mayo.
Yo fui en un autobús y mi papá caminó y yo caminé y llegamos. Hacía mucho calor, no pude saltar.
Lo llevó a agarrar migración y ya no lo soltó. Ahí fue donde nos separaron de la niña.
Yo lloraba mucho por mi papá.
Él llegó llorando y como temblaba. La verdad, él decía que le dieron números, pero marcaban y no nos contestaban.
Me dijeron que estaba en Michigan, pero no estaba en un albergue, estaba en casa de una familia.
La otra señora me llevó, que ya te vas con tu familia. Me sentí muy feliz.
And then I'm gonna show another clip that was the next day in the morning. Yancy was gonna go back to school for their first time.
¿Ustedes son amigas de ella? ¿Vale que sí?
Sí.
¿La van a ayudar?
Sí.
¿Viste, nena? ¿Sabes que aquí tus amiguitos te quieren mucho? ¿Sí? ¿Sabes que te aprecian mucho tus amiguitos?
Qué bonito.
Y que querían volverte a ver. Entonces ellos te van a ayudar, mamita, a salir adelante. ¿Sí? Pero vas a volver a ser esa niña que eras antes. Vas a volver a reír como eras antes porque tú no eras así de seria.
Acá se lo pusieron.
Tal vez.
Era una niña muy activa. Ya no es la niña que yo dejé de ver hace 5 meses.
Mira, ven, vas a participar y vas a... Mira, ven, para que se te olvide todo lo que te hicieron por allá, ¿sí? Que Diosito se encargue de cada uno, el que te pegó, te humilló. Diosito, mi amor, tal vez los gringos pueden decir que no te pegaron, no te hicieron
La tristeza nada, se le ve reflejada en esos ojitos que trae como perdidos. ¿Qué es lo que pasa por esa cabecita? Yo siento que esto solo se lograría con ayuda psicológica. No tenemos un psicólogo en esta escuela, pues es una escuelita muy pequeña.
Ya que tú hablabas, ¿verdad? Ahí hablaba ella.
Pues sentí miedo porque yo la vi muy como espantada.
So the documentary then goes on to follow her for the next week after she returned. And she, that same afternoon and a lot of days after, she would start crying all of a sudden. Her parents, for example, shared that she would wake up in the middle of the night and stare to the wall. And she had these very fixated look that actually, when I was filming these, I did not know that it was this association. So, but a little bit of behind the scenes of this story, it was a very community-rooted story because we had, of course, like many other outlets, covered family separations on a breaking news level. And we had been hearing about the effects of this policy on kids when they were reunited with their parents. Some of you might have seen the social media videos when this toddler gets reunited and starts running the other way. We had seen certain moments visually, but we had not really seen how that reunion looked up close and in a longer term. So we were really looking into ways of telling that story and just observing what happened. And in this case, one of our colleagues lives in a very Guatemalan community that's up north from Miami, and she happens to be the neighbor of Yancy's aunt. The aunt is an undocumented immigrant in the US that is not in the piece and is off the record. The aunt was desperate. Like many, many parents of children separated, they could not locate the girl. The family knew nothing about where the girl was. And basically, that's how we found about this story. We initially tried to even thought about going to Michigan, where the girl was. And we finally decided it was better to go to Guatemala, meet the parents, and then wait for the girl to arrive. So we did that. And once we arrived, besides what you have seen, something that is remarkable to comment as well is that the girl was deported with a big bag with a lot of toys and things like that. In that big bag, there was also a folder of documents that the mother showed us. Some documents were in both English and Spanish, but some of them were only in English. And among them was a clinical report from a psychologist in Michigan that very clearly stated that Arayansi had PTSD. And there were early signs. The reason why we chose to tell this story and choose to observe this story, there were early signs. Yancy in Michigan had been crying a lot. That phone call at the beginning is with her aunt without stopping to cry. She had cut her own hair as a form of protest. She had been very vocal about, I want to return with my family. So obviously we had to tell the family, this is what these documents say, and the parents were very worried. They wanted to take her initially to a curandero, a local, I don't really know how to translate that. A little bit more of, sorry, my thoughts are all scattered. I also wanted to talk a bit about the behind the scenes of the school scene that you watched. I was the one filming the whole piece. We were two of us working on the field, a photographer and me doing the video. And filming that scene was really, really challenging. First of all, I was at the beginning, I was observing what was happening with my camera next to me. And I was seeing the girl looking into the horizon, just like you see her here. And I was very shocked. My first reaction was pure shock. And I thought at the beginning, I wasn't really understanding what was happening. I thought at the beginning, it was because of me. It was influenced because of me. I was in front of her. I was with a camera. She was reuniting with her friends for the first time. And I felt terrible. I felt terrible. I tried to take myself out of the equation. I went to a corner of the room behind her and started observing her, no camera. And she, of course, kept looking into the horizon, wasn't talking. She did not talk for the whole time she was at the school. And I was like, okay, this is not because of me. This is seriously some trauma going on here. So I started crying, like bawling, and there were children all around. So I had to get myself out of that room. I cannot cry here. There's a lot of children. So I compose myself, and then I go back and I film what you see here. So there was a lot of processing that I had to do as well, and a lot of self-care that I have learned how to do afterwards, and a lot more understanding about trauma. But I thought that would be important to share. And I'm not sure if I'm forgetting anything. I also wanted to briefly talk about, I think I have a couple of more minutes. In this one case, of course, there were a lot of ethics with consent and a lot of discussions we had about consent. And we had obviously discussed a lot about what we wanted to do with the parents before going there. And in the process of, for example, interviewing Yancy, which I did, at the beginning, I wanted to make this piece about Yancy. I thought there was a voice that had not been heard in the conversation at all. I wanted this to be a first person account of what was it for a child that had gone through this. And very quickly, I think I didn't do the interview until the third or fourth day with them, so I waited for a while. And it was very clear when I started interviewing Yancy. At the beginning, she was playful and she wanted to share, but soon after she withdrew, and it was very clear she didn't want to talk. She was really not in a good place. So the shift then began to incorporating more voices in the family and being as the least intrusive in Yancy's life as possible. I really tried to be a fly in the wall, which is difficult with a camera, but I also work with small equipment, so that helped. And In the last minute, I wanted to also just share, because I know this has come up in the conversation, we have, because we report on immigration and we report on a lot of things that have been and are very sensitive, we have done a lot of experimentation with alternative ways of working on really sensitive stories, especially with children, without showing faces. And I think it's necessary to talk about this in the immigration context, at least in the US and in other places with refugee populations. I, for example, and nowadays rarely go anywhere without a macro lens, which is a lens that photographers use to film insects. So you have to be very close, but you can also get slices of images like the ones in the previous clip. And sometimes in this story with suicide and really young girls suiciding, that came in very handy. We didn't disclose any identities, location, names, and it was very clear because of the subject of the sensitive matter that there was no question it was going to be a very different story than Yancy's story. So the voices of the girls were there, of the survivors, but their identity was in no way, shape, or form revealed. And that type of macro photography sometimes helped. And we've also done a lot of experimentation with animation and illustration. And this is just part of the, for this one project, we did a 10-minute documentary, and that's a little animation clip that we included. But we've done a lot of experimentation with animation with basically a lot of different stories with refugee children. That's it.
Doesn't matter, any order. So as before, I'm gonna start the conversation with a few questions, and I know lots of queries, ideas, thoughts in the room. Thank you all, first of all, for being so thoughtful and generous and sharing so richly of your own work and revisiting what are challenging places, challenging encounters, and challenging stories. And it actually leads me to the first question I wanna ask each of you. What do you know, if anything, about how the various protagonists you introduced us to are doing now? And actually, Donna, let me start with you. Any of the last few photos that you showed?
So Myra, I don't know, because I haven't been back to Colombia, but the story took place, the initial meeting with her was a project I was doing with UNICEF, and I met her in Bogota at a rehab center. And the photographs that I made later of her when she was learning to walk is after her family moved to a different location. The event, that the traumatic event that caused her to lose her legs, didn't happen in Bogota either, but we felt it was still, because she knew the identity of the people, it was a house bombing, and she knew the identity of the person who put the bomb there, and it was very sensitive. So we didn't want to reveal her identity, but after they moved her, her mother felt it was okay, and that's why. So, you know, that's something I think I want to stress as well. Sometimes you can't show people's identities in certain moments, but later on, you can tell other aspects of the story when the situation becomes safe. And so that's one reason it's important to stay in touch. And also, even in the situations when they are facing risk, I often make photos for them that are of, you know, show their faces. And it's another way to help me kind of cement a relationship so that I can stay in touch. But yeah, I can't say that any of the people, because it's older work, but I do stay in touch with people in the period when I'm making the work, usually for months and months afterwards.
And you've occasionally stayed in touch with folks for years.
Well, of course, the gang work that I did, which I didn't show, in Los Angeles after the end of the Civil War, I came back to the United States and was photographing the diaspora community and the problems that young people had. And so I photographed in the 90s the emergence of Salvadoran gangs in LA, and then how kids got deported to El Salvador, and that's how the gang spread. So some of those young people I'm still in touch with. Yeah. I've had relationships for 25 years. I'm godmother to children of some of them, and you know, it's very personal.
Laila?
Yeah, the family that you saw has been resettled in Germany. I think they're pretty happy. They had another child. We try to keep in touch as much as possible, especially around the holidays, like Muslim holidays, I'll check in and I'll use that opportunity to just see how their life is going. But I think it can be a bit of a tricky balance. At one point, the mom was asking me, her son, the younger son's still getting medical treatment. I think he probably will for the rest of his life. And she wanted me to do some research for her and I wasn't sure if she meant, can he come to the U.S. for medical treatment? Then I had to explain the U.S. medical healthcare system to her compared to Germany's. I was
not a good idea. Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah. No, I think they're doing okay. And I hope to meet them in Germany someday. It could be great.
Almudena?
So, Yancy, of course, the film ended in a worrying and one could say depressive way. Because of course she lives in a very rural area and she cannot really access treatment. So something that happened very much like in Layla's case after the film run, there was a fundraising that started happening for Yancy. So I think $2,000 were raised and she started going to therapy in a town that is about an hour away from where she lives, with a Guatemalan psychologist. And then soon after, or a little bit after, the short film received a major award that was also had a cash value. And we among the team that participated in this project decided that it wasn't ours, that money wasn't ours to keep, and we wanted to contribute it to have Yancy get better. Also did some discussing about if there was a way of contributing to therapy for other kids that had been returned to Guatemala. Long story short, it's finally being dedicated to Yancy and her community and sort of like out of our hands, but Yancy is getting the help, but we are also aware that she is very much an outlier, and I've been doing a lot of thinking about all the rest of the kids that have been deported and have no resources whatsoever to get treatment for very similar symptoms.
Mm-hmm. One other thing I wanted to ask all of you, I was struck that all of you one way or another were struggling in different ways with the issue of how to depict of graphic depiction or non-depiction of graphic things. I mean, Almudena, in the last suicide piece, you use animations to pull people, or I can't remember if it was a suicide piece or a different one, but you were using animations to distance people from abstract stuff. Laila, you decided there to show us what, to me, the most shocking parts of the film are those very explicit images of the younger child's skin. And for anyone who's had a child or been around a child, that's just a horrifying kind of thing to watch. And obviously, Donna, you've struggled with this, not so much in these pictures, which are after the fact and distant, but in other work. So much of on this terrain of refugees and children, when public attention gets raised, with the sole exception, I think, of the John Moore picture, it's been a really graphic depiction. How do you think about that? How do each of you just frame that for us, those choices? Laila, you're laughing.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really, really, really tough question. I was thinking about it a lot watching the images. Alan Curdy, the father and daughter, I think, on the border. And people have pointed out, and I don't know if I agree with this, but I think one of the arguments people make is that it's often like maybe people of color whose images are put out that way. And I don't know what I think about it, and that's why I think I laughed, because my answer is I just think it's very contentious and very difficult subject, and I don't know if there's actually a right answer, but I think it's good to have the conversation and to hear other opinions and to hear out people who say that You know, you mentioned the National Association of Hispanic Journalists, like to hear out that perspective, because I think it's an important one. As far as, you know, Abdul, the little brother's skin, I think in this case, it's a medical condition. So I think to me, it was more straightforward that we shouldn't stigmatize a medical condition, that it is rare, but it's shows, I think, in a pretty graphic way, the stakes involved of turning away, you know, sick children from medical treatment. And now, you know, this administration is trying to take that number of refugees admitted down to zero. That's the next step of this. So I think it's just really sometimes shocking. The conscience is the only way to get people to pay attention.
Yeah, we do a lot of thinking about this at Univision. I also have no answers, and I'm always asking myself ethical questions. So what I can say is that I think there's a lot that we as visual storytellers can do beyond the breaking news photography, of course, of thinking about metaphorical ways to show grief and trauma, and ways in which we alternatively can depict things without showing exactly what it is. I talked a little bit about animation, but also just thinking more creatively. I don't think I am successful at this all the time, but before any shoot or before I go out, I always make like a little list of ways in which I could, if I know it's gonna be a story about X, Y, and Z, and a kid whose dad was killed or something happened, I will try to make a wish list of images. In my case, it's filmmaking, images that, or sequences, or types of things that I could think about. And then when I'm in their home, I will make a list that same night as well, seeing their environment and having talked to them about what their activities are. And I don't know that that is a solution, but I think we also have a responsibility to be more creative on our end.
I agree. And I think we have to think also about the different, you know, the point that you brought up about the ethnicity of the children, right? These are all non-Western white children. A lot of the discussion about Alan Kurdi was that he was so white-looking that people in Europe could imagine he was one of their children. And that's part of why they reacted with such, you know, pain when they saw it, and with anger to try and change something in the moment, right? And we hadn't seen a lot of images like that for a while as well. So much depends on the context visually, what's going, what, you know, what images are circulating, and then the different cultures. You know, so I think that the Association of Hispanic Journalists, you know, who are seeing a lot of violence all the time and on the border, really feel that this is dehumanizing. And, you know, in El Salvador, where there's a lot of imagery that's very graphic all the time, and it's so normal to see graphic images on the front of newspapers, yeah. That image was actually a tender image and more metaphorical image for that audience than it may be for us. So it's very difficult to make. That's why it's important to have these conversations, because we're receiving different information depending on what perspective we're coming from and where we're located and what's been circulating. Sometimes we need to be shocked, and sometimes shocking images when we've seen too many of them, or it also affects people differently depending on your own personal experience. If you have experienced trauma, an image that's not even that shocking can sometimes trigger you. Regardless, so it's
and I suppose, I mean, a couple other things occurred to me as all three of you were talking. One is that, of course, in the history of visual journalism, there have been moments when graphic images had extraordinary power and were pivotal in changing public consciousness. The famous one in the U.S. is the mangled body of Emmett Till, a young African American man lynched, whose mother chose, and therefore satisfies the criteria, whose mother chose to put his body on display, his mangled body on display in an open coffin and have it photographed by newspapers in 1954.
But I would also argue that part of the reason that that was so effective is because there was already a social movement, a nascent, the civil rights movement was starting to organize. And so there was something to do with the feelings and emotions that that image stirred up.
Yeah, very.
Right?
And I get the other change in context is social media, which is a pipeline of graphic imagery. And in a way, I suppose, now we're making choices knowing that graphic imagery is out there. Graphic user-generated content is out there. Unmediated gore is out there. And so our curation choices are, what can we do that's different? What can we do that changes the conversation or that adds or that adds a level of craft? So, okay, let's go to the room. I'm sure a lot of you have struggled with this, so.
Well, thank you guys. I'm just gonna ask about, I haven't seen something for so long, for too long, and I'll argue that people of color, it's so, for a long time, seeing pictures of famine and, you know, so when any other picture from Africa comes out now, like, okay, what else do you have? How do we recalibrate? I mean, I understand that Alan Kurdi's picture had that kind of reaction. Thanks for putting in perspective. Like, we've never seen a white boy like this before. Oh my God! With all due respect, so I just want to be sure.
The white boy's in the wrong
game.
Really, it's okay.
All due respect. So, and I, when I was coming here quickly, I was having this conversation with a colleague of mine, and he said to me, ask in that room why these days pictures of people of color doesn't have as much reaction. I mean, look at Alan Kurdi, and then we've been trying to get attention, redirect attention back to what's happening there, and we're not having much success. Ask, and thank you for putting that forward, because I was like, that's a very weird question to ask, but I'm grateful for that we sort of feel the same way. So for me, in the business of visuals, I may not even have to say too much words. I just need to have the right picture to tell my story. It's so difficult for the continent that I cover. Like, people have seen it too much. It's like, please offer us something else. I'm looking for innovative ways to recalibrate and, you know, get people's attention back to what's important there.
I was gonna comment. I'm sure you know about it, of course, but there's the whole Everyday Africa movement and the whole Everyday. There are projects that were born on social media out of a discomfort with the images coming out of Africa and portraying more everyday moments and a lot of that. And the movement has really grown, and I think the initiative really has come to spur a lot of other initiatives, like collectives of photographers of different continents. And there's a lot of conversations now with photo editors as well, with like trying to keep Excel tables of really watching out for their representation and who they hire, because that is really important, right? It's also like we need to amplify those voices, all those photographers who are from those countries, from sub-Saharan Africa, and their view is completely different. And I think there are some resources out there that maybe writers or other types of journalists that are not photo editors might not know about, and we can pass a list, but there are some collectives that are really great, and maybe you think they have a lot of limitations as well, and we can certainly discuss. I think there need to be more conversations.
Yeah. Carol?
My question, I think it's more for Bruce and Donna on a university level academic discussion. I don't know. In Brazil, we have something different situation as in the US. In Brazil, you cannot publish the image of a child without their parents or guardian's consent written down or specifically. So, and like I work for the major communications group. So for example, I cover the entry level exams for university. So a lot of the students that we interview are minors. and I'm not allowed to talk to them unless they have a really good story. Then I need to get their parents' phone number to call them and record the conversation, or ask them, or they can pose for the picture with the child and have a family story. So this is always something that we always have in mind when we're covering children. And when I went to Greece, for example, in Greece, it's also illegal. But a lot of journalists there, they were from the US, or they didn't know, they didn't care. They would just take pictures, and the more sensational they were, the better for them, you know? So is there a discussion here of how we should treat them if there needs to be a legal protection of children's images?
I don't need the mic, I've got the little here. I mean, as a legal matter in the US, restricting images runs into a constitutional problem. We have the First Amendment, right? So that even with minors, that would inhibit a lot of those kinds of laws, right? Instead, it's a conversation about ethics. It's just purely about ethics and what our responsibilities as journalists are. And there is a very robust conversation that comes up in particular every time there's a school shooting or anytime you get into a disaster or a big public event that involves the depiction of young children. It's more about self-regulation within the profession. But you raise a really important point, which is that for any of us, particularly if we're trying to build the kind of trusting relationships with NGOs, with communities, with families, knowing and respecting law and ethical norms in a particular place is really relevant. If we're trying to build trust to tell stories of vulnerable people running roughshod over local, whether it's law or custom, is not gonna help the story and not gonna help us help the kids, right? So I think gaining a layer of knowledge about these things wherever we're working is probably really important and not something I actually had put into my own what you need to know little mind, so.
I agree. I think that's the right answer, right? That we need to know the culture that we're engaging with and respect that culture and right. Not act as, you know, because for example, even with schools, like if my photojournalism students want to do a story about kids in a school in Austin, Texas, they have to get permission from the principal and often they have to get permission from the parents to take pictures, you know. Within the school. If they're on the school grounds, it's, you know, even if it's a public school, it's not public space.
Right, you can't, schools are entitled to protect kids, so. Yeah. So.
Yeah. So.
Let's get the mic, hold on.
Thank you. What happens with like indigenous people? Because we were with the Yucpa and the Warao and the Wayuu, like through the Venezuelan border, and they're, most of them are naked sometimes, especially children. And we wanted to make a story because their bellies were like incredibly
extended,
inflated with parasites and whatever. But they were naked, and like we were trying to cut the head or like in the picture, it's very hard. And the moms were around, and I was talking to them, and I was having the names and everything. But it's like, can we publish that? Is it? It's like a fine line of.
That's yeah.
You're the photographer, not me.
If this is the norm of the culture, there's, you know, it's complicated. It depends. Your publication may have a policy that they will not show naked children. And it's complicated because of the internet and because of child pornography. You know, there's so many issues now. Like this wouldn't, you know, if back in the 1980s, I think I would have given you a different answer. But now, yes, I would look for ways to not, to be able to show it. Very young children, I think it's okay. And if it's, you know, you're trying to show the health issues, right? That's the focus.
There's a lot of conversations that we do have also newsroom-wide about the representation of people going through immigration proceedings and seeking asylum. And I think I want to think that the policies that we are creating are a bit more liberal than maybe those of other news outlets that might be covering this issue in a stricter way. For example, because we have a lot of experience covering Central America and other regions, we know firsthand, there are firsthand stories of people who were interviewed and then the day after something happened to a relative, right? We don't want that to happen. We are fully aware that these people are in a lot of danger, especially people fleeing for safety. So we are actually creating more stringent policies on anonymity, on when we can grant anonymity. I think we grant anonymity more liberally than other news outlets. And we put a lot of effort in trying to protect the sources first. Oftentimes, either not publishing faces, or for example, I can think of one example of a short documentary I did where we did publish faces and it was an ongoing negotiation with the family, but we made a lot of effort to disclose the location, like literally maniac. So you couldn't tell precisely what state or city or no names of anything. We put a lot of effort into that. And I think newsrooms need to have more conversations about that visually.
Laila, does your shop have the same arguments or policies, or how does it go?
Yeah, definitely. Al Jazeera English, as far as I know, has a policy of not showing a moment of death on air. I'm not sure that Al Jazeera Arabic has a similar policy. There's definitely, I would say, more graphic images on the Arabic channel. I think partly it is a cultural context. But what's interesting, I was thinking when you were talking about just how even social media has changed things. So let's say a news organization doesn't show a moment of death, but then there's videos of police killing, mostly unarmed black men, right, on the internet that do. And it's, do you as a news organization continue with the policy, so it's just.
Right, when the images are out there. Yeah. Go.
Yeah, I just wanted to follow up on this topic because for me in photography as a freelance, I change outlets all the time. Rather than a question is like, a commentary I wanted to do. For me, it's a lot about self-regulation. And I'm not wondering, should I use this image or not? But what comes first to my mind is this image useful? Is this image dignifying this situation? I really need it. And if I really need it, then that's about trying to work with a sensitive eye. And so, trying to see, our profession is a lot about learning every day how to see things, so that's the detail, to me in photography. And now, for example, sometimes there are very complicated topics like death or disappear people in Mexico, Central America, and there are great photographers that are doing a great job, with more abstract images, and some of them are doing great. In other situation, as we were talking with Donna, you feel you're missing a content, So sometimes I think it's really important to get those images, but get them properly, And then if you are dignifying a subject, that means that you have spent time with them, and so you won't have problem with that image.
Yeah, Netta. Well, we need the mic, so for video purposes.
So I think it's more for Bruce and Donna because you combine story and image together, but I would like to hear your take or your point of view about the relationship between text and image and how can, I'll leave it open.
I think you have to have both, always, right? I mean, the image without words just is it could mean so many different things. And that's part of the power of photography, right? That it has this power to be a metaphor as well as, but you don't want to lose that organic connection to the actual situation, I think, or you want to try to keep that alive. And I think, you know, when I think of a photographer like Susan Mizellis, for example, if you know her work, I mean, she covered the Nicaraguan Revolution, and then she went back and she did a film where she went to find the people that were in the pictures and interviewed them 10 years later, and then she brings the work back. But every 25 years later and puts big pictures in the places where she took them originally and has a community conversation about historical memory, those are, you know, that's something that a documentary photographer does, maybe a journalist doesn't do. But we can always find new ways to recontextualize, and I think we have to have, you know, we have to have words to do that, right?
One of the interesting things about both of your the video clips that you showed us is that you had to make a lot of choices about when to let the images and the video simply be, and when to explain, textualize, contextualize. How did you think about that?
So I most often work on non-narrated work, which means there's no correspondent. So the context that we provide is, like you saw in that other video, is little text cards. And we try to have them be as brief as possible, ideally very few or none. So that is a challenge for the interviewing process. But in terms of context, I, for example, in Yancy's story, it was very clear that the moment at school was going to be a very powerful scene where that just had to speak for itself. But then, of course, if we had, and it was actually interesting. Oftentimes when we work on stories, I always say the editing part with photography and with video, the editing is what makes the story, right? You need the raw materials and you need to capture it well, but in the edit is where you can craft what really you want to say. And I think it's a craft issue, definitely. I'm always trying to look at engaging the viewer pretty early on. This is more thinking digitally, so it's not necessarily a captive audience like in cinema or maybe broadcast. But also fairly early on as well, contextualizing. What is this going to be about? This is normally a text card or two that puts you in place, always locators, and then just thinking about the materials that I have. It's like what needs to tell the story by itself and what needs contextualizing. So in the case of that Yancy story, there was a text card about how the document showed she had a PTSD diagnosis, and then the ones you saw about how she was deported after being separated and the locator. But that was basically it.
I think in our case, I came to learn about the case through WhatsApp and through videos that the father was sending me. And early on, I felt like that was a key part of it, is just letting those videos speak for themselves. Generally, the way we approach our stories is really giving as much time and space for the people at the center of the story to kind of tell their own story in their own words, and then kind of using the correspondent to explain like the details of the reporting, to show the reporting process, and to pursue accountability.
Yeah. And actually, related question, this is what we're talking about video for. Go ahead, Donna, what were you going to say?
With video, you always have voice, and you have natural sound. Right, and that's a little bit when I was saying you always have to have words with still images. I don't mean you have to, I hate when people go into a place and they look at the words before they look at the image, right? I mean, look at the image and feel the image, but you need to have context to sort of know what you're looking at, and that's what I really meant.
This is directly what I was going to ask of you two, too. About sound, about the audio part of video, I noticed for the first time on seeing each of these, though I've seen them each a bunch of times, you made some decisions, both of you, to put subtle music in addition to some natural sound at some key moments, almost as if it was sort of mediating the emotions of what might have been an overwhelming moment. I don't know. Talk about that a little bit, the sort of how you think about, and this is especially important on very emotionally rich stories with young children, who very evocative images and so on. How do you think both about natural sound and the soundtrack?
I think it's definitely a big issue, and it can make or break a documentary piece, in my opinion. For example, in my newsroom, we had some discussions about music in Yancy's piece in the school scene. We had a lot of discussions about if it should start in the school scene or it should not, and whether to put music on that. And I felt all the time that that scene, there's no way it can have music. I mean, it speaks for itself. It's just too powerful. If you put music under that, you are, in my opinion, killing it. You're making, you're emphasizing on an emotion that is already there, and that's when you cross the line towards, like, you're pushing down something down someone's throat. And I always try to be watchful for that, and work with music that sometimes it does help convey a little bit of emotion in transitional moments or certain scenes that do not have as much emotional power. But I have to say, early on in my career, I found it very instructive to work on purpose on several pieces with no music. And that was a really good exercise, and I always tried to ask myself, does this scene need music, yes or no? And if I'm just putting that music there because I don't have enough time to play with the natural audio, then the answer is always, no, it does not need music, you should take it out.
Yeah, I think it's a craft issue, and it's a lot of times subjective, so I can't tell you how many times in the edit, like, we'll be like, no, that music track is terrible, and someone loves it, and, you know, it's just, it's a negotiation, but I think it's, you know, generally you want to be as subtle as possible, and you don't want to feel like, you don't want your audience to feel manipulated, so I think it's a very tricky balance.
One more? Yeah, go.
This is a question more about production. First, I wanted to thank you, Laila, for mentioning how important it is to have a local during your reporting. I live in Guatemala, and we often get international reporters who tend to be imprudent, I guess. So I was kind of wondering, how do you prepare the three of you with that cultural difference? How do you tackle that cultural difference when being on the ground or before?
Really good question. I mean, I think being very transparent about who you are, where you're coming from, not even though, you know, I'm an Arabic speaker, I didn't try to pretend like I shared his experience, because I think that could be very disingenuous and phony and, you know, just all sorts of bad. So I think just being really clear about who you are, where you're coming from, what your background is. I think a lot of times we tend to ask our subjects to open up so much to us, and then we're like walls, and we don't give back. So I think it's like also just being a human being and establishing a rapport and breaking bread and having a meal in a way that's just very human and not like, give me, give me, give me, and then disappearing. So, and then really just trying to be familiar with the culture, the local context, you know, something that may be surprising to you but totally normal to them, just, you know, not being judgmental. I think a lot of times we can go into a culture and just be really judgmental or look down or, you know, call them out on something we don't agree with. So just being respectful.
Yeah, and I think also, so for example, in my case, I have done a lot of work in Central America and Latin America, and I am not Latin American, I'm from Spain. So I oftentimes have some sort of imposter syndrome, like maybe someone local should be telling that story. And sometimes I have friends remind me, like, no, you've actually worked in this region for a long time, and you know more than what you think you know. And it's also, there's certain, I think, mode of working that goes into really sensitive, I think, photojournalists and documentary filmmakers that I admire. They all take a lot of time to prepare. No matter if you know the region and you've been to the country before, you take enough time and you care. So you want to be well prepared and read about the specific town where you're going to, but also just
in the beginning, for example, is like, if possible, I never put the camera out immediately after. So I want to get to know the people, like Laila said, be very transparent about what you know, what you don't know, what you're excited to learn. I always try to have an honest conversation with people about how I really feel like I want to tell their story through their point of view, because I work on non-narrated work. So all throughout the process, I'm trying to show them things and also try to ask them, what else do you think we should film? It's like a very collaborative process in that way, and I think that's very important. And no matter where you come from, that's something that could bring you closer and make you learn more, because you're not making the decisions, but you're also giving them the agency again of like suggesting things and working with you. And I think that's something that's changing, and it wasn't that in the old days.
Just one quick thing I wanted to add, which is for long form, like what we do is documentary, it's also setting expectations about the amount of time you need to spend with them. I think a lot of people are shocked because they're used to like quick news crews or someone doing a news package. They're like, what, you need like two days, or you need hours of my time? So it's, I guess, what Ginger said about like leaving at the right time, but I think it's also setting expectations early on about how much of their time you need.
No, I agree. When you've exhausted your time, but also I suppose because I went to Central America when I was, you know, in my early 20s, and you know, worked in the region for a long time, it feels like home to me in a way. I have so many friends. I know so many journalists there. I always want to have conversations and see what they, you know, tell me is happening.
This is important.
So when I worked in El Salvador in the 80s, I would live with the campesinos in the countryside and stay in their homes and, you know, share everything, you know. I felt that that was important for me to really understand the story from the inside, because I'm from the outside. I wanted to get as close as I could, you know. Treat it like it's your family, you know.
And one of the things I know about you is that you do actively nurture and maintain strong relationships with colleagues in the countries where you work up until now. And I think that's something that both on the visual side and on the print side, too many of us don't do. And especially on sensitive matters of children, families, these things that are just so, such powerful cultural issues, being informed by relationships, by local relationships, is what helps make good decisions.
I try to, you know, I'm a professor now, so I still do my own work, but I try to help young photographers in El Salvador and Guatemala, you know, tell the stories and get their work published and anything, you know. I'm always engaged in trying to do, you know, training, and if anyone writes to me, I'm always there, right?
So maybe one more?
That's a very simple one. How long does it take to make how long do you guys spend on the average documentary you make? Because some people just want me to do magic.
Typically, it's 3 months, beginning to end.
Really? Okay. 3 months.
Yeah, typically, but
she's now the executive producer. She gets to decide.
For the band, it was actually much shorter than that. The story broke, I think, Friday, January 27th. We were on a plane a week later. So generally, that pre-production time takes at least, I don't know, anywhere from like 2 to 4 weeks. But in this case, it was a few days. So obviously, with a breaking news story, it's a shorter timeline. It was also edited quite quickly. Just to get it out there, but and we feel like sort of a moral obligation when someone's story is unfolding to actually get it out there very quickly. But if it's an investigation or a more in-depth piece, then it's about 3 months.
Okay, so that takes 3 months, but what's the average? A month, two, or 2 weeks? Never 2 weeks, right?
Amadeen, how long did that piece take?
So Arayan Si's piece took a month from start to finish. That is not counting with the time of what we call pre-production, which would be like talking to the family. And I mean, it took 3.5 months since she was in Michigan, but since filming to publishing, it was a month.
Okay.
But I do think it's possible. I mean, of course, I know in broadcast news, I think it's very challenging. I do think it's possible to get out things that are very decent in a couple of weeks, but it really depends on the story, and time always, always, always equals better journalism. I think there's no substitute for that.
Yep. Oh. Okay, well then let's, Mike.
Did you need to get the consent of families of the kids in the school, the other kids in the school?
Yeah, we did get, the parents were also there in the surroundings, so yeah. But we did that, no, I think the school helped us do it before. Sometimes we do it after. That's a practice that sometimes if you're filming something that is developing, it's not ideal, but sometimes you just film it and then ask for permission, basically. Like, I've done that a bunch of times. I have this kid, and then you track the parents to get permission.
Okay, well, thank you all, Donna and Laila and Almudena.